Welcome to the water crisis panel that has been sponsored by the Story County Democrats. I'll try and stay far enough away from this so I don't make weird noises. Make sure you come up front. Those of you who are looking for seats still, we aren't going to call on you. But you will be welcome to ask questions if you would like to. I am State Representative Beth Wessell-Kroeshell. I represent House District 45 in the Iowa Legislature, and I am running for re-election for my 7th term. And if you're wondering what House District 45 is, it's wards 1 and 3 in Ames, and then Grant, Milford, and Washington Township, including Kelly. So I'd like to make a few announcements and identify and thank a few people. First of all, I want Hash Patel and Anna Suri to raise your hands. They're in the back. These are our campus organizers. And if you have not updated your address on your voter registration since the last time you voted, or if you need to register to vote in Ames, we would like you to go back and see them and register to vote. And also fill out a commit to vote form so that we make sure that you have a plan to vote, we know how you're going to vote, and make sure you get to the polls. So this is what they're going to ask you to fill out. So thank you very much to Hash and Anna for being here today. Then we have some office holders and VIPs. Jan Bauer, of course, our county chair. Thank you, Jan, for being here. Kim Weaver, running against Steve King. Santa, yay, Kim. Laura Solson, running for Story County Board of Supervisors. Linda Merkin, running for Story County Board of Supervisors. Two separate positions. One's a 2-year term, one's a 4-year term. Just make sure that you know that. State Senator Herman Quernbach, I saw him come in. Okay, and then we need to thank the people who organized this. I think water quality is probably one of the most important issues facing the state of Iowa. And when Story County Democrats decided to make this an evening where we're actually going to talk about this important issue, you can't be more proud of the group of people who did that. So John Klaus, raise your hand. There you go, right here. Selden Spencer. Jim Gaunt, John Coleman, sorry, I can't read my own handwriting, I was going to, Zach Rogers, Chair of Story County, President of Story County, or ISU Dem, sorry, Marcia Thompson, yeah. Put the cookies out there, and Jan Bauer again, so did I miss anybody? Sherry. Peha here, who is running in House District 48. House District 48, Slater area. Okay, so we have a great panel of experts up here, and I want to take the opportunity to introduce them. I don't think there's anybody who doesn't know who Bill Stowe is by now, but maybe you didn't know that he grew up in Story County in Nevada. He has of course you know that he is the current manager of the Des Moines Water Works. He has a BA in economics from Grinnell, a master's in engineering from the University of Wisconsin, a master's in industrial relations from the University of Illinois, and a JD from Loyola University, New Orleans. That's a lot of degrees. I just read them out loud and it suddenly occurred to me. So thank you very much for being here. He also likes Harley Davidson riding, and beekeeping. We also have Rick Cruz. He's the current director of the Iowa Water Center and professor of agronomy at Iowa State. He's in the middle there, right? Another highly educated, he has a BS in agronomy from ISU in 1972. He has a master's and a PhD in agronomy from the University of Minnesota. was a research assistant at North Carolina State University, faculty ISU since 1979. He's written 87 papers and 11 book chapters. But his most famous, and you need to go to YouTube for this, is he's heard as a part of a rap hit with Jacqueline Camito called Slow Jammin' Soil Erosion. I highly recommend that you go there. Careful what you're famous for. And then we have a farmer, and we're so so grateful to have a farmer from Clarinda, Southwest Iowa. He's the owner and farmer of Pinhook Farm in near Clendra. He's the fourth generation with the farm, which started in 1846. He assumed control in 1994 and runs a cow-calf operation with hay and corn. Pinhook is a part of the Iowa Learning Farms. Seth's grandmother was Jessie Field
Shimba.
He said it. He pronounced it for me, but of course I forget, who helped found the 4-H program. So I think we have a great panel from a wide variety of perspectives, and we are going to start with Bill Stowe.
Wow. Good evening, everybody. Am I audible?
Yes.
All right. Well, thanks for joining us tonight. You could be at home glued to CNN watching Donald Trump going from Clive to Philadelphia with his daughter Ivanka. I'm sure that he would be more entertaining than we'll be, but hopefully we'll be a lot more factual. Great to be here, and I've got to tell you, the three of us are a little paralyzed to be without an ability to give PowerPoint presentations. You're going to hear us trying to square off on what the problem is, what some of the solutions are to what has been termed as a water quality crisis. And I have to say that I use the term crisis with some soberness. When I lose my car keys, when I forget what my next appointment is, when I'm even afraid that I lose my wallet, it's not a crisis. It may be a problem, and it may be something that I don't like, but when we talk about losing the ability to safely drink this, that's a little different than other commodities that we're accustomed to dealing with. Water, as we all know, is absolutely critical to our biology. It's different than a lot of things that I've worked with in my life, like electricity and like telecommunications. I come from that portion of the utility business before I came into the public sector, into the job I'm in now. It's certainly not fun to lose your electricity for a day or two, but it's not a crisis for most of us. This is a commodity that's critical. Two-thirds, three-quarters of your body right now is water. At conception, it was 100%. Three-quarters or so of the Earth's surface is water. Very small portion of that is available for human consumption. You get the point. Water is a scarce and continually scarcer commodity that is beyond comfort, it's beyond aesthetics, it's critical. And in this state, unfortunately, we have forgotten the importance of water in many ways. I think we gave it up as a recreational amenity many years ago. In my lifetime, having grown up in this area, this was always Lake LaMud, right across the road. And when my family wanted to go someplace to vacation, we went to Wisconsin or Minnesota, or if we're really fortunate, we saw our family in California. That was pretty cool. But going to most amenities, surface water amenities in Iowa for recreation is something we as Iowans, I think, have unfortunately written off. Maybe we can reclaim that, and people like you are going to be important in that process. But now we've reached a point, particularly in this area of the state, the center portion of the state, which continues to grow in terms of population, in terms of economic development, where it is increasingly difficult to turn surface water into something that we can drink safely. We'll talk more about that, but the basic problem are agrotoxins in surface water, particularly nitrate concentrations is what you certainly hear a great deal about in our lawsuit and in our public proclamations. This year, we're actually more concerned about something other than agrotoxins, than that particular agrotoxin, but blue-green algae and a microtoxin that comes from that is more haunting to us this year than nitrate. But unfortunately, that's an agrotoxin also. In Iowa, surface water quality is driven by land use, and in Iowa, land use is agricultural land use. Row crops, animal feeding operations, and particularly because of some of the unique issues associated with the Des Moines and Raccoon River valleys, the so-called Des Moines lobe, different hydrogeology, different kind of drainage pattern, different use of private and public underground plumbing systems, stormwater systems, basically to move water away from the root zones of soils in north central and central Iowa. We have a lot more concentration of pollutants in central Iowa than we do in southern Iowa, as an example. And that really is the basis of our lawsuit against three upstream counties, and I'm confident, as part of this panel, we'll have an opportunity to talk about that. But the problem, primary problem, is agrotoxins in surface water. I think there are two other problems that I would want to square off on that are related to that before I lateral it to Rick to give you a, I'm sure, a very interested view, an interesting view about the contributors to that. But there are two kind of tangential topics that are problems also. First is this one. Many in the political leadership of this state, both parties, are in denial about this issue and basically say, oh, it's weather related, it's getting better. Watch one of the great black and white TV ads with yours truly in it that have take every opportunity to talk about things are really getting better, and it's the urban versus rural troublemakers with long hair from Polk County trying to impose their will on the world. And you'll get a sense that there is a real theme of denial out there. And that denial is certainly not based in science and certainly not based in good public policy either, I think. But that's ultimately for us to talk about here, and we will be talking about it, I'm sure. The public policy third problem that I would raise with you is kind of this rush to now, whether it's Terry Branstad or whether it's others, run to the idea of solving the problem by throwing more money at it, more of your money. And I would suggest to you that part of the reason we're in this problem is we've thrown too much federal and state money into production without being concerned about conservation, and to throw a bunch more money upstream to producers without tying that to conservation is going to spend your money and incent bad behavior. I'm tired of a sprinkling of biofilters and cover crops and photo opportunities for Bill Northey and for Terry Branstad or whomever to ribbon cut someplace. We need coordinated public policy. We need real public policy that looks beyond things like sales tax. And I'm not a real lover of the public policy of sales tax anyway, but I'm particularly skeptical of it when most of that sales tax is going to be paid by those of us who live in Story and Polk and Johnson counties that'll go upriver to producers to essentially relieve them from a problem that they're profiting from at our expense. So the basic problem, agrotoxins, subsidiary problems, public policy leaders that are in denial, or public policy leaders that are racing to throw a bunch of money at the problem without assigning accountability and responsibility to those who have created the problem. I'm confident we're going to have a good discussion. I know Rick and Seth have a far different perspective to add than mine, but without PowerPoints, we're going to be really responsive to your questions in a few minutes.
Am I on?
Yep. Yeah.
Oh, boy. Full disclosure, it's full disclosure season, right? I do work for Iowa State University. Well, at least I had a job before tonight's talk. What I say is my own and not an official representation of Iowa State. Okay, that part's done, right? And you can probably tell I've got a cold. Yesterday, I could hardly talk. I come into work today, and one of my buddies says, "Guy, you got a cold." "Oh, I don't. I'm just reaching puberty. Here's your sign." And the point Bill made, no PowerPoint. I spent all day putting something together that's probably worthless. An academic without a PowerPoint is like a glass of iced tea without ice. An academic without a PowerPoint with laryngitis is like a glass of iced tea without ice or the glass. Okay, so do we have a water crisis? I'm going to argue a bit differently than Bill, but not totally. Toledo had a crisis. Des Moines had a crisis in 1993 when they flooded the water system. California has a crisis. Flint, Michigan has a crisis or had a crisis. I think Iowa has a challenge, and our responsibility is to find a way to make sure that challenge doesn't become the same kind of crisis that we've seen in other locations. We have an opportunity at this time to be proactive rather than reactive. Proactive allows you to strategically plan, strategically use resources, and more efficiently accomplish the goals that you're after. So why is this such a big challenge? Well, there are a variety of things that are occurring that make it difficult for farmers and make it an issue in which we are the far dominant component of what we're seeing that we're trying to clean up comes from the agricultural sector, bar none. So what is it about this agricultural sector that makes it so difficult? Having said that, you know, I'm an optimist, but when it comes to Iowa environment and water, I tend to be a bit pessimistic. Now, having said that, I've experienced a couple of events. I'm on an advisory council for the Iowa Soybean Association. Some of those folks are really unique. And some of those, we had a half a dozen farmers there, and they continually were asking questions, what can we do better? One guy says, Tom Oswald, Northwest Iowa, says, "I was planting soybeans in rye cover crop that was hitting the toolbar." He says, "My neighbors are laughing at me, but you know what?" He says, "My soybeans look good as they do." And others amongst that group did the same thing, gave me a breath of fresh air. And then at the Farm Progress Show, a guy named Tim Oswald came up to me, and Tim was a member of the Iowa, not Iowa, National Corn Growers. And he said, "Do you remember me?" And I said, "Yeah, Tim, I remember you." And he said, "Do you remember a meeting we had about 20 years ago in Strawberry Point?" I said, "Yeah." He says, "You know, at that meeting," he said, "when we got done," he said, "you were talking about no-till and about conservation practices. When I left that meeting, my thought was, now what the heck has that guy been smoking?" But he says, "You know what?" He says, "Every acre that I have today is no-till. Every acre that I have today is cover cropped." These individuals that I'm talking about not only are striving to make life better, they are very frustrated with their counterparts who refuse to do nothing. We must be very careful that we don't throw those individuals, and we have one of those here to my left, right? No PowerPoint. Without a PowerPoint, I can't tell. You're right, my left. We have to be very careful we don't throw those individuals under the bus because they are our absolute best tools for us. Tim Recker said, "I'm on the speaking tour always." Okay, so why is it such a challenge? Just a few items. You know, we are morphing in agriculture from agriculture to agribusiness. You know, and that's an important difference. The mantra for the culture is that if we do everything right, money will come. Seth is a great example. Agribusiness, the mantra is, if we make enough money, I can buy what I need. Those are completely different items. And when we shape policy, we have to understand the difference between those two. You know, we are industrializing agriculture, and I'm not trying to say that in a bad way. But it's something that's happening. And when you say industrialize, what does that mean? I mean, I used to hate that term when people would say that. It's just somebody that's upset and trying to, you know, make farmers look bad. You know, what does industry do? Industry specializes. They narrow their focus. They simplify their system so that they can then capitalize on economies of scale. You know, but what does industry make? They make solo cups. They make chairs. They make eyeglasses. They make tires. They make things that don't live. What do farmers do? They manage biological systems. Biological systems don't do well in a simplified arena. Biological systems and resiliency of the system thrives on interactions. We are trying, not we, but there's an element of what we're dealing with. We're trying to develop a farming system where you can write all the directions on the back of a postage stamp. In a biological system, working in a leaky system, soils are leaky. They have to absorb water. They have to infiltrate water. Water has to move through. It has to get to the rivers. In a continuous row crop system, it ain't gonna happen. Fully support what Bill is saying. Do I do that very often?
Not often enough. Right?
Okay. You know, our challenge isn't that farmers aren't growing cover crops. It's not that we don't have enough bioreactors. It's not that we don't have enough riparian areas. Those are all help. They're tweaks on the system. They're fine tunings. But the issue is the cropping system that we're addicted to. How can a farmer volunteer in a totally volunteer system, and I'm not pushing the R word, I certainly won't have a job tomorrow. I don't mean that either. How can a farmer afford to invest in conservation practices? And conservation practices in some do cost. To make this happen in a volunteer system, the incentives and the benefits must align. Now, what do you mean by that? If I own property and I'm going to farm it for the next 30, 40, 50 years, the incentive that I have to spend the money today to keep soil and water in place is the benefit that I receive for having a better farm later on. If I'm renting ground, what is my incentive if I don't know? And not all leases are like that you're not going to know tomorrow. Some are long term. But there's a lot of competition. You know, if you don't know that you're going to farm ground for more than a year or two, what is your incentive to use conservation practices? The majority of Iowa farmland is rented.
Yeah.
21% of Iowa's farmland is owned by people who live outside the state. Having said that, we have some very, very good landlords. So again, you can't throw all those people under the bus either. So, since I don't have a PowerPoint, I can't talk anymore. What are the elements of a solution? Number one, I think we must have the political will to address the problem and not the system, not the symptom. The problem is the cropping system. The symptoms that we're trying to fix it with are the cover crops. And I'm not knocking cover crops, not at all, because they are part of the system.
You're talking about system, right?
Okay, good. to make this thing work, we have to have that political will. We have to have the support for the type of practices that some, all farmers are not going to. We have to decentralize the livestock industry.
Yeah.
If we're going to have a chance to make this work. The greatest and best, am I taking your time yet?
You're doing great.
I wouldn't go that far. The best tools that we have to clean up water are perennials. Let me say that again. the best agricultural tools for profitability and for water quality are perennials. If you don't have livestock, why would I grow a perennial? That's another major issue. I lost my voice. Thank God, go ahead, your turn.
I believe.
Just push and hold it.
How's that?
There you go.
All right. I think I've got it from here. Kind of contemplating without my slides, I think the first thing that came to mind is why you want someone entirely out of your watershed to come talk about the practices I do to protect Des Moines water. But the reality, and Bill touched on this, we're not just dealing with a nitrogen issue. We're dealing with agrotoxins. We're dealing with phosphorus. We're dealing with sediment. We're dealing with endocrine disruptors. All these are things in our water that are really keeping Iowa from being the great state I believe we can be. And the other thing Bill mentioned, and it's bothered me for some time as I've watched this, Bill really doesn't need to be vilified on this issue. I think if we really think this through and look at it from someone from a very small rural community and from that perspective, you'll notice it's not just Des Moines facing these issues. There's 60 communities in our state that are dealing with serious nitrogen issues, and the majority of them have no means whatsoever to take the nitrogen out of the water. So when I thought this through, I thought, you know, I wanted to do some kind of a gesture of goodwill to let Bill know that I actually appreciate what he's trying to do. And I thought, what could I get for this man? And I know he's a biker, so anyway, I got you a ride bell.
Cool.
And it happens to be an Aquarius ride bell. Now, I don't know if Bill is a February birth date or not. I've been told all great men are born then. But he's definitely a water bear. And for those of you that don't know, ride bells, when they ring, you mount them on your foot peg, and when they ring, it keeps the evil spirits away and it keeps you safe on your motorcycle. So you're covered. You're welcome. So moving beyond this, from someone outside of the watershed looking in, I guess there's a couple of things I think about with it. Like I mentioned before, my perspective, and I hope Bill can elaborate on this, it looks like if this goes to a judge, this is only going to specifically deal with nitrogen. And like we've discussed before, we're also dealing with these other issues, phosphorus, sediment, endocrine disruptors, some of these issues. And all of these are what are known as externalities or negative unintended consequences of a failing system. And as someone involved in agriculture and I see the things going on, I do think that to ultimately fix our water problem, we have to fix not just our farming system, but our food system. And we have to identify our roles within these systems. For a long time, for me as a farmer, industry has looked at me and they said, you know, Seth, you're a producer. You're the greatest producer. You produce so well. You feed the world because you produce. It sounds kind of familiar to the political rhetoric we've heard. And they tell me that this is so important because I'm feeding the world, yada, yada, yada. At the end of the day, as I really thought about this, I realized where it comes important and where Rick talked about biological systems. My job isn't to produce or feed the world. My role in this food system as a farmer is to care for the land.
Yes.
When I do this properly, and it does take a lot of tools, I think there's too many people to be in an idealistic, all organic or all conventional world. I think there's tools on both sides that we use to build these systems. But when we do this properly, the land does take care of us and other things fall into place. The best way I can see this is to help farmers change their thinking. Once again, I think this will have to come somewhat from industry. I think that there are definitely, the good news is there are ways that we can farm, there are practices we can put in place that address all these issues. And I think, like we talked about, the important issue is one of the questions is how do we fund it? the concept of I Will is a very good program that I see to help us do this. It's something that, once again, would I hope be conservation-based. I think that's been one of the concerns in the past. And I think the other one, and if I've seen any encouragement in the last couple of weeks, the other part is when you deal with a broken system, there's a lot of placing blame and pointing fingers. One of the first steps I've seen, and it is encouraging, seeing what the Farm Bureau announced last week, is saying, you know, we do have a problem and we're part of it. And that has not happened for a while. Now, I don't know the rest of the details of that. I'm probably too far from Des Moines to understand that. But those are things that matter. So I can talk to you about different practices we've applied and how they work. It's a little harder without slides, but ultimately we did touch on, you know, cover crops are a part of this, saturated buffers, waterways. Ultimately, what I want to do with my farming system is figure out a way that I use. I want to find a balance between nature and science, I guess is what I'm looking for in a nutshell. I'm trying to find that sweet spot. I want to find practices that allow me to use less nitrogen, or I want to find practices that allow me to use legumes in place of nitrogen. I want to find practices that allow me to back off of my chemical needs, some of these areas. So I guess what I'm going to describe in a nutshell and wrap my part up, I think the premise is called conservation agriculture is what we're after. There actually is a name for it. What this means is farming in a way that we use minimum tillage or no-till. It means keeping as much cover on the ground as long as possible so that we both protect soil and sequester carbon. It means our crop rotation with three species or more, not the traditional corn soy. We're seeing some progress on this, but Iowa has to move back to this concept. And finally, it means farming in a way that promotes and enhances wildlife. And examples of that would be things like the Strips Project at Iowa State. It would be the development of wildlife corridors, restricted or riparian buffers, some of those things. So I'm going to leave you with that and let you guys ask me any questions you want.
Thank you very much. And I will, if you will raise your hand, I will bring you a microphone. And Sherry first, and then. When you consider spending public dollars for conservation practices, would you find it reasonable to ultimately shift those conservation dollars to all watershed projects rather than scatter cover crop money throughout the state and not really have it be effective over the course of every year, basically? Would you support, you know, picking a watershed and then really focusing all that public money as a demonstration project, for example?
Engineer will figure it out. Watershed approach makes a lot of sense, Sherry, and clearly the Des Moines and Raccoon Rivers, in our view, are uniquely positioned to be those demonstration projects because of the impacts of drainage districts on our watershed relative to others. So we certainly appreciate the watershed approach, appreciate the prominence probably of our watersheds on the Des Moines and Raccoon Rivers, 10,000 square miles. Large area, obviously, but realistically, a fallacy of the public funding issue is not tying the public funds to specific outcomes on the conservation side. There are a number of folks who you and I know and the panel are familiar with that would tie conservation practices to a water quality improvement plan, as an example, that has specific accountability tied with public dollars. The public dollar issue in and of itself is the threshold here, and it's certainly, I think, worthy of a lot of discussion, but running to throw a bunch of public money at a problem without a clear solution is an echo of the past in a lot of ways, where we have incented production, more and more corn, more and more soybeans, particularly more and more corn, without a real concern about protecting the environment in the state. So I'm a little queasy about the rush to public policy solutions without a greater accountability in the producers for an outcome. But certainly you pointing out the watershed approach makes a great deal of sense. Demonstration projects on the Raccoon and Des Moines would make most sense to me, because that's where we draw our water from, as you know. But the idea of simply raising a sales tax or appropriating a bunch of money through Des Moines or through Washington, D.C., without a very different shift in how we view the use of public money ultimately to jumpstart responsibility from the producers, that has to last beyond the public money, I think is going to be key.
You're on.
I'm on. No, I don't think he is.
Yep, he's on.
Oh, he is?
No, you're right.
I'll use the engineer's mic. I think you need both, Sherry. I think the focus in the watershed is to genuinely generate improved water quality that can be demonstrated, that comes out the bottom of that watershed. Distributing, for instance, cover crop money across the state, the modus operandi there, I mean, is that going to have an impact on water quality? Absolutely not. But what it will do is it will incentivize producers to use it and try it. And some that do and are successful will continue using. So one, I think, is a product-driven approach, the watershed approach, and the other one is education.
I guess I'd chip in on the latter part. Good things do beget good things, and I think the other thing is it's really hard sometimes for us to understand things we have not experienced. So what we have seen historically in agriculture is something of this nature, where there's cost share dollars for these projects. It helps us to adapt. And once the practice is in place, you don't even think twice about it. I was studying this, where we live, we have lower pH in our soil. And in the 50s, they had to pay farmers to apply lime to their land. Now, after doing that for a couple of years, farmers adapted and they realized, gosh, this makes a big difference. It's part of what I do. I think that's the tough thing when you're on our end, on the production side, and once again, you're hearing this, you gotta raise, raise, raise. Right or wrong, at the end of the day, a lot of Iowa's farmers are gonna say, we need some money to give this a try.
Okay, I guess I'm on here. I own 45 acres on the Squaw Creek, and I've trained people not to put dirt in my creek, although it wasn't my creek originally. I call in the DNR, and I publicize it in the newspaper if they do this. I have two points. One is the DNR, I mean, since I've had them come out in previous administrations, is the DNR become politicized by the present excuse we have for a governor? And two, I believe there's some increase in CRP. At a workshop at Iowa State, in which my husband and I were pretty vocal about farmers, what we learned was that, you know, upstream from here, there's more farmers putting land in CRP, and also in southern Iowa, where we don't have very good land. And I hail from southern Iowa and ancestors. So what does this mean? Are we doing better in these two areas, or in this area as well, as whether we politicize the DNR?
Well, on the land part, what I've seen, it goes back to what I talked about earlier. You know, Iowa's 9 different geographical regions. So the Southern Iowa Drift Plain, where you're from and where I live, is it's 600,000-year-old soils. They've been around 590,000 years longer than the lobe. So we do have different problems. The sad thing, and I think why farmers sometimes we feel a little gun-shy about things, bad policy decisions make us more and more nervous every time. The really rough one was the 80s, when the Fed decided to raise interest to 22%. And what happened after that happened, with that, was bankers panicked. And cows were liquid, so they said, sell your cows and raise more corn. And we plowed up way, way too much of that land. And because it's very hard for policy to be specific and unfortunately sometimes make common sense, once they plowed up too much of it, they realized the first thing they should do is probably get it back into grass. Here's what's cool, and this is where all of you can help advocate. There's a company here in Ames called Ag Solver. And Ag Solver has come in and done what I think is simple and brilliant. They've helped us identify every single acre as an individual business unit on our farm. So we can pinpoint the land that is productive and the land that isn't. Now we can get into the sour grapes of saying, why are you farming land you shouldn't farm? But just to stay with me for the greater good of our state, what if we could simply put those acres into CRP? Now right now, if you have a really creative person at your county office, they'll draw something out that kind of looks like a spider web and they'll tie all those pieces together and you can kind of put it in CRP. But the common sense thing would be to say, gosh, let's get Ag Solver involved, let's identify this land that's not working, put it into a program like STRIPS that's developed right here at Ames. And not only are we going to stop farming non-productive land and burning those resources up on it, as farmers I can dedicate resources to the better land. We're going to do something that's not only going to restore habitat, but in most cases, it's also going to help protect the soil and some of those other areas. So this gets back to the complexities of it. On the DNR, I've dealt with every single branch of the DNR as a farmer. We have an outfitting business, so I've dealt with the wildlife branch. We have a feedlot, so I've dealt with the what we call the DEQ, or the environmental side, and I've dealt with them on different water quality projects. You know, I think, to be honest, their problem is they're trying to identify a moving target as well, because you have the DNR and the EPA, you have a federal and a state agency, and they are spread thin, and I think they don't have a clear, I don't think they have a clear idea of what they're dealing with. Sometimes, you know, like my brother who's in the oil business points out, we're regulated and we don't mind it, but when we get our regulations written, they're clear and there are no ambiguities, so we know what to expect. And this kind of goes to what I'm hearing Bill say too. You know, I really hope in my heart that in this idealistic Iowa, we can all get together and figure out a solution. And maybe, I don't know how the things work, maybe they could like table the lawsuit if we really had our act together and we're working in the right direction. But the only reason you could do something like that is if you knew in your heart people were really working to write something clear and direct. With the DNR issues on water, I have seen where the DNR thinks they have a standard for water quality, and I've seen the EPA change it, or I've seen different agents come in. They're just doing their best. You've got to take the approach that people aren't out to be difficult.
Well, I don't think the agents themselves are. I'm talking about what comes down to them. The governor likes to micromanage.
Well, I think other states' governors might, too. I mean, it seems to be a... We're in a challenge there, and I'm not trying to stand up for anyone, but I think one of the issues you see with a failing system is you see a lot of finger pointing and a lot of placing of blame instead of getting down to what really matters.
I can't miss an opportunity to weigh in on the DNR question, and I may be weighing it a little bit differently than you think. First of all, whether it's my organization, which is a lot smaller than the DNR or the DNR or the EPA, you know, at the top, there are folks like me that probably have a different view of the world than the people who do the real work. A plant operator right now sitting in a control panel in Des Moines, Iowa, making water, may not share very many of my views, including the lawsuit or whatever. The real point is that organizations, even as small as the one I'm part of, function pretty well. Leadership at the top can do things to impact visibility and impact within goalposts, if you will, portions of the organization. On the DNR side, Chuck Gipp and I frankly disagree on just about everything, including what day of the week it would be. But he was appointed by a governor. He's following the governor's lead on environmental issues. Was once a very gifted legislator himself. Again, I have no disrespect for him nor the ideology that he follows, which is very different than my own. the DNR, frankly, I think does very well in the complex world they have of wildlife issues, and as was pointed out by Seth, and then real environmental issues, which are air and water quality issues, real science issues, not wildlife biology issues. So I think they've got a mixed charter. The one thing I would certainly point out to you that you as Democrats need to be very concerned about is any movement to put the DNR under IDOLs, under the Department of Agriculture. I hope you have a sense of what a disaster that would be for environmental protection in the state when air and water quality issues are largely influenced by agricultural interests. To have the DNR under IDOLs would be a disaster, and certainly has been a policy objective of some leaders. I'll also tell you, as Democrats, whether it's Gina McCarthy or Chuck Gipp, on issues that I'm involved in, I can't tell one from the other. The US EPA is no more helpful in my world than the Iowa Department of Natural Resources, and that's a huge disappointment to me, and a disappointment that I think we need to rectify and will rectify over time. Ultimately, a big issue, and Rick didn't want to use the R word, and he wasn't talking about Republicans, he was talking about regulation. In my world, there is a huge disconnect between the idea that environmental protection and public health can be protected by voluntary practices versus a real world where I pay income taxes and I set my speed control at 70 miles coming up at I-35, not because I'm a good guy and a nice person, but because it's the law of the land and I'm accountable for violating the law. We need to get to that point, in my view, environmental protection in this state, where we're no longer dancing with this ugly date of believing that the producers can voluntarily decide in the average. There are always going to be exceptional folks like Seth, just like there are probably people who would pay their income taxes if they didn't have to because they're nice folks, but there aren't enough of those folks. And that's the dilemma we have in Iowa, and that, in my view, is the ultimate concern that I have with the DNR, where they don't even advocate for reasonable regulation. They believe, as does Gina McCarthy, the US EPA administrator, that this partnership between industrial agriculture and the regulators that says it's voluntary for that business, agribusiness, to engage in conservation practices, but certainly isn't voluntary for the city of Ames that collects stormwater out here and has to have a permit for how it discharges into Squaw Creek, or its sewage treatment facility that discharges from the sewage treatment process into the waters of the state. That's very regulated, but if I'm engaged in agribusiness, I can take a pipe to Squaw Creek, and it's unregulated. And in the aggregate, it's that unregulated agricultural producer that's having a far greater impact on the waters of the state and ultimately the Mississippi River than the municipal storm sewer system in Ames and Des Moines.
We've got Jay. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I don't know if it's on.
No.
No.
Just push the button on the bottom.
Hold it.
Okay.
Hold
it
down.
Hold it down for a little bit.
Hold the button.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh.
I just wanted to speak on the same things that you talked about.
About
regulation and so forth, because I think the the finding out who owns which parcels of land and doing something about that so that you can see where stormwater is going and how polluted it is something that we need to do. But I know the city of Ames has a code, and as a homeowner, I'm not allowed to put foreign chemicals or anything in the storm sewers. And if there's a water course near me, I just looked at public code today. I'm not allowed to put anything in that waterway. And if I do, I'm fined. So there's a penalty there. And I think it's very unfair for homeowners and people that own land would have to pay farmers for them to do what they really should be doing in the first place. And so by keeping their water clean and their land in proper shape. And I do think that there should be regulations with penalties involved because they're landowners, just like we are. Only they live in the country and we live in the city. They're larger than we are, but so what? I mean, what farmers do, and even what landowners do, are either beneficial or detrimental to the whole rest of the population. So, anyway, that's what I...
Let me try to give these guys on my left, on your right, a slow pitch here that they can run with on the, and not put them in a position where they have to weigh in on regulation, because I think your voice is gone. Well, yeah, that's all right, Rick. We'll use a Ouija board if we need to. You know, ultimately, and Seth mentioned this in his remarks, we all should be supportive of sustainable agriculture. And sustainable agriculture ultimately involves understanding the cost structure of farming. And right now, there's an externality from production that involves moving the cost of corn production from the producers to us as water consumers. And that's cleaning up the mess that's coming out of the drainage pipes into the waters of the state. If we really want to promote improved water, we don't want to over-farm, and we want to engage in conservation practices. It involves taking a cost of production back to the producers. And I don't know of any way to do that voluntarily. That has to be done through regulation. But perhaps I've opened up the opportunity for you all to talk a little bit about externalities in production and sustainable agriculture without having to get into too much of an ugly fist fight about regulation.
Gosh, I'm not slowing up. No slides. You know, first of all, your question is one that I actually brought up with the group when we were having supper beforehand. I said there are going to be people that look at this and say, why should I vote for a sales tax increase when I didn't cause the problem? I think it's what I'm hearing you say. I think, once again, I've got to turn back to history and some of the things that I've watched build in agriculture over time and policy. It's probably easiest for me to go back to the 70s when Earl Butz said, get big or get out, and that was our farm policy, and we're going to use grain and food as a weapon. We're going to have a cheap food policy in the United States, and through those pressures, our system evolved to what it is today. The soil health issues are just one externality of this system. If I knew there was a solution that we, as farmers, could come into this and make the change in the time required, in the short time required, without asking for the public's support, I think it would be wonderful. But the best way I can answer this is that as I look at our state's soil and water, and I look at what we've done to it since we laid the first plow on it in the 1840s, we have degraded to a point that as our population grows, if we really want to deal with what we're facing in a growing world, we really all need to work together to restore the health of the soil and do things like get the carbon back in it where it belongs into the atmosphere in some of those areas. That's going to take all of us. I don't have a better solution, but I do know, working with my fellow farmers, and like Rick mentioned also, once we figure out something, we get after it, and we do it well. But all these practices have different improvements and different ways to make it better. At the end of the day, you know, I'm always trying to think 10 to 50 years down the road. I believe that this investment is something that will pay back tenfold to all of us. But unfortunately, we all are going to have to chip in and pay for it. That's the best answer I can give you.
Hello. In regards to the Dakota Access Pipeline, how do you think that that would affect Iowa as a downstream state in that? If that were to go through, how do you think that would affect Iowa's water sources?
Nobody wants to touch it.
I'm going to surprise you on this one. Full disclosure, I worked for Big Oil for many years, Royal Dutch Shell Oil. So I've worked in refineries and I've worked in well fields, and a little bit of appreciation for the importance of energy. I also have an appreciation for how things move in commerce. And what I am concerned about as a water producer is river crossings, in particular relative to pipelines. I have a unleaded gas pipeline that goes right up through one of my reservoirs in beautiful Polk County, the Maffitt Reservoir, if you know where that is. Big unleaded or leaded pipeline comes up from Oklahoma through us and ends at Clive, where you see the big tank farm, if you know where that is, in Clive, Amoco Tank Farm. So some familiarity with pipelines, some familiar with energy, and certainly a lot of familiarity with water. My concern is this: I'm not a huge anti-Bakken advocate, surprise, surprise, perhaps for you, because I'm afraid that oil is going to move, and if it moves by rail or moves by pipeline, I prefer pipeline.
One of the questions, I sort of see two issues kind of emerging. One is that we have done our conservation consistently using design standards rather than outcome standards. We said if you do, and we never tested it, because I guess farmers are worried that if we find out the design doesn't do what it's supposed to do, we'll blame them. So part of this is some of the public money really needs to go into monitoring. And we have to convince farmers that if we're monitoring the impact of their practice, it's not because we're blaming them, it's because we're trying to figure out, does this work on your property under these conditions? So part of this is changing our mindset to just having a whole list of great practices that may work wonderfully on your land, but another part of the state won't do much, to say we are really all in a constant experiment to constantly improve. And part of your payment to do the right thing, what we think is the right thing, is to monitor it till we find out if it does the right thing. And so what we're testing is not the farmer, but the practice in that place.
I appreciate that comment, because it's something we've thought about a lot as we've worked, you know, with the learning farms. We work with other farmers. It's farmer-to-farmer learning. And in southern Iowa, one of the practices that became very popular in the 50s was building terraces as a way to manage water. What you have to remember, a couple of things have happened since the 50s. One, since the 90s, we've had incredible climate change, significant weather events, and we've also had this growing population. But what we forgot about, until the mid-50s, we still used horses, and we still used this great three-crop rotation of, at that point, you know, soybeans weren't quite in, but it was corn, cereal grains, clover, some of these issues. And I think what was happening is our organic matter was probably much better in the soil, and the structure was better in the soil when we started building terraces. And as that organic matter depleted, the terraces didn't start to work as well. But the solution was to build a bigger terrace, because no one really looked at the real issue of a depleting organic matter in the soil. Now you can build terraces as tall as this building, and they're still going to blow out with a storm because of that issue. So it's, once again, you know, when you go to school, when you go to Iowa State University, and you learn that building a terrace will solve your problems, you believe it. And this goes back to my comment that we really have to come, our world and our agricultural systems and our food system is far too complex to address with linear solutions. And You know, I know most of us are auditory learners, that's why we don't use slides. But there's that 5% that I'm a visual learner, and I have to wrap my head around things a different way. It's been really helpful to me as I've built my system. It's been very easy. A lot of other people have to have more of an introduction and an understanding of it. And there's ways to do that. There's great programs. MIT has a great program to help people understand this.
I'd like to kind of take more of a satellite view of the problem. In addition to surface water problems in Iowa, there is the great dead zone in the Gulf that occurs, I think, seasonally. The dead zone in the Gulf, is that eutrophication nitrogen limited or phosphorus limited? And of those two nutrients, of the total total load going and being discharged into the Gulf by the Mississippi, about what fraction of that would be assigned to Iowa?
I think we're 2 for nitrogen and 3 for phosphorus, but Bill might know better than I would.
Close enough.
Yeah.
and Rick, if your voice miraculously comes back, jump, because this is really your area of expertise rather than mine. Let me just step back for a minute and make sure that we're all on a common vocabulary. When we talk about nutrients in the water, we're generally talking about, as you've suggested, nitrogen and phosphorus, and there's some other things that come, magnesium, there's some other things that come into play. But the eutrophication, the dead zone in the Gulf, both are contributors. In the that is, both nitrogen and phosphorus are contributors to this idea that the maritime activity is so intense that essentially it depletes the oxygen and kills an area that's roughly the size of Connecticut and Rhode Island, I think, together. And I lived in New Orleans for a number of years. It's a real phenomenon for shrimpers in the Gulf. Put all that together, and it again points to, particularly on the nitrogen side, which is what I am concerned about as a water treatment person. And let me just give you a little water treatment 101. You go down and look at Squaw Creek. I won't send you to Lake Lamud, but the Des Moines River, the Raccoon River, and look at it, and you know, it almost looks like cappuccino. Obviously, it doesn't look like this. The three things that we're concerned about as a water treatment business are suspended solids, microorganisms of some sort, and then nutrients. The suspended solids are basically the dirt. You know, you look at it and it looks like cappuccino. You let it sit and a lot of it will settle out. We're able to remove that pretty easily in my business, and that's where most of the phosphorus is, or at least a significant portion of the phosphorus is attached to the soil. So not a big issue in my business. The microorganisms, but for some of this blue-green thing that we're seeing right now, we've not been terribly concerned about, because we use lime, and we talked about lime a little bit earlier as a soil additive, but we use it basically to change the pH in water and kill off microorganisms, viruses and protozoa and bacteria. Pretty good at doing that. The problem that we have, and that most of us have in Iowa as water producers, is removing nutrients, the molecular kind of stuff we're talking about, nitrogen and phosphorus. Nitrogen in particular is very difficult. Our traditional add chemicals and use filtration, sand filters, doesn't deal with that because it's too small of an issue. It's too molecular of an issue. We've got new technology in my business, and Des Moines Waterworks has it, that uses reverse osmosis and filtration. Very expensive to be able to do that, but you know, most small towns aren't going to be able to do that. So the remaining problem is nutrients. It's not microorganisms. It's not suspended solids or soils. And it is a real challenge for us, I think, as Iowans, to feel that we're making real headroom in this. The nutrient reduction strategy, which we haven't talked about, it's kind of the official public policy of voluntary conservation practices to improve the levels of nitrogen and phosphorus in our water, contributing to eutrophication or the dead zone, is an all-voluntary process. And that's where, from a public policy standpoint, we back into the idea that there are 22 million acres or so that are cultivated in this state. There are all kinds of practices that these guys can talk about far more literally than I can, cover crops and biofilters and strips and saturated buffers. As a water treatment person, frankly, I don't care which of those practices. I'll leave to the experts what they should use, just like hopefully you leave to me what technology we use to take out microorganisms, as an example. So one size doesn't fit all, but the problem in this state is you got 22 million acres and conservation practices touch, I don't know, pick a number that's small, 4 million of those acres. So we continue to have the nitrogen and phosphorus problems that go through our rivers into the Mississippi River Valley, but it's particularly intense in this part of the state, just like it is in Toledo, Ohio, where they lost their water supply in a crisis, as Rick talked about, and in Champaign, Illinois, where they use groundwater rather than surface water. But surface water, for a lot of reasons, is what most large cities rely on, not only here in Iowa, but in the United States and in the world. And realistically, it's sustainable. Aquifer water, water being drawn from the Jordan Aquifer, doesn't recharge quickly enough. We're using far more of that, even in Iowa, than we do in states that are far more populated, like California, where the aquifers are literally being drawn down by inches every day. Long answer to your question. I hope it was responsive, at least.
Nitrogen.
Nitrogen limited?
But look at our practices and what they do. Wetlands remove what? Nitrogen. Saturated buffers remove what? Nitrogen. Cover crops basically take up what? The nitrogen is the key.
Hi guys, I'd like to know your thoughts on hemp as a phytoremediator used to pull phosphorus and nitrogen out of soil and water and other places, and also as a potential economic source as a cover crop to incentivize people to grow that kind of grass on their land that can aerate and prevent some of the erosion and compaction things we see. Your thoughts?
I like your thought. First of all, I don't really see hemp as a cover crop. I see it as a very potential good crop for Iowa. And just to kind of clean this up too, hemp and marijuana are cousins, okay? Hemp doesn't have THC, and hemp is actually a really versatile crop that could be used for fabric. It has oilseed. It has some real potential for what I see as Iowa's weather. I'm not the agronomist here. I'm the farmer looking for a third crop. There are several states that are doing this now, and we raised hemp until through World War II. Every time I say the war, I mean World War II. We raised it for, you know, some of these reasons. I don't know enough about the ridding process to say that it's less toxic or environmentally harmful than what they do with pulp or other ways to make paper or cotton, which I know is a very needy crop. But I know that wild hemp grows very well on my farm, and I'd love to have it as an option for that beloved third crop for where I live. That's all I know about it.
Seth likes your question. I like my job. I'd address it if I had any knowledge about it.
Hi, Steve Bishop. I retired from Iowa State a few years ago, and back in 25 years ago, the Board of Regents wanted to sell the Lakeside Lab. And I wrote a proposal to change the Lakeside Lab, because really not a whole lot was going on, into a regional prairie cotton hole research center that would incorporate research and activities that would go all the way up to through Manitoba, Saskatchewan, down in, as far as Kansas, and deal with the prairie pothole biome and look at all of the different changes that were occurring with agriculture and use of the land. Well, I brought the Board of Regents, of course, looked at this and they weren't very enthusiastic. because Pomeranz wanted to sell the lakeside land. Turns out they didn't own it. But the idea was that it would set up a regional center that could take care of the data that had already been collected and then work on the biome and the water and use of the land and the problems of, like when you drain all the ponds and then people complain about the geese coming to town and and then inhabiting the ponds and towns. But anyway, the Board of Regents, in their infinite wisdom, were not enthusiastic, but I still think it's a wonderful idea because it would bring together all of this data in a central location, not just from Iowa, but from all up and down, all the way to Northwest Territory and Hudson Bay. But so the idea of doing this was an anathema, and the response I got was, "You want to build another university in Northwest Iowa?" And I said, "Well, maybe." And he said, "Well, we don't want another hog at the trough. And what do you think about setting up a regional center? And it can still be done at the at up there at Okoboji, at the lab on Okoboji Lake."
That can be done. It's not a bad idea, but you'd have to go through something like NSF to get one of their regional ecological research centers. You won't get it through the state of Iowa. But the idea is good. The idea is great.
I have a question about those things that nobody likes, regulation and tax. So ever since I moved to Iowa, I was told that the state feeds the world. Okay? So if the state feeds the world and we were to impose regulation on producers, wouldn't those costs be spread then to the entire world, since when you impose a regulation, price adjusts accordingly to cover for that expense? But what I'm hearing is in Iowa, well, we should just tax Iowans for that expense. And apparently, we're not the only ones being fed. So I'd like to know what you think about that.
I guess that's my question. You can't put the toothpaste back in the tube. So sometimes when you deal with something like this, I guess what I want to do as a farmer is be able to sleep at night. And that's why I want to make sure that people understand the concern facing our soil and our water, and why I appreciate some of the concept behind IWIL. I do believe this goes back to where I stated myself, and you might be interested in reading like the Plate of the Union. I think you would find very interesting. I would like to see us once again identify that third crop so we truly are in the food and fiber business. Like Rick says, the decentralization of the livestock industry would help us in some ways do that. I think the priority right now is the soil and the water. I don't know what else we can raise in Iowa. Right now, the powers that be have put the pressure on corn and soy. We have ventured on our farm. I have ventured into raising other food and selling it directly. Both times we've done that, it's ended in a colossal failure, because I'm not a marketing expert, I'm not a logistics expert. I probably need to develop those skills, and I hope there's a place to help me do that. But the way the system works right now, it doesn't lend itself to that. Might not be the answer you want, but sometimes when you're dealing with a dog knot like this, you focus on what really matters, and that's soil and water.
Let me just talk for a minute on feeding the world. Thank you for giving me that slow pitch. We don't feed the world, we don't even feed ourselves. You know that 90% of the food that you're getting at Target or wherever you're getting it is not coming from Iowa. So that's a myth. We feed our gas tanks, and we feed into an economic development strategy at the state level that says, you know what, we need to produce more cheap nitrogen through anhydrous plants. We need to have more hogs in confinements that create more waste, that create more nitrogen, that create more water problems. Those are serious issues that, for me, kind of underscore that the idea that the yeoman farmer and free markets and rational production and cost of production being weighed against the commodity and consumer pricing are a myth. It's a myth that we need to keep pushing back on and should push back on. There are a lot of great, not enough, but a lot of great folks in the local foods movement and the organic movement that are not part of the model that's failing, that's causing all of us to have public health concerns. We need to focus on what we've done to distort the market, all the federal money we've thrown to producers to incent the wrong behavior, federal flood insurance that's underwritten in the wrong way. We'll have an opportunity to write a farm bill in the next few years that hopefully, ultimately, will better reconcile the very issues you're talking about. But there's no question that this idea that massive producers and those who are connected to the commodity and retail markets and agriculture are making big money and pushing what should be costs of production to those of us as consumers is a very real part of the distortion that we face. We need to push back on that and recognize that really we're talking about now in Iowa, because of the rationalization and industrialization. Both these folks have talked about, what do we have, 90,000 or less farmers in the state? It's heavily concentrated, heavily capitalized, and no longer, you know, Grant Wood and the beautiful pastoral world that I still enjoy from time to time when I ride through Iowa. But it's big business now, and it's big business that's poisoning our water.
The mirror side of the opposite side of regulation is current policy. Get the policy right, which is part of regulation, or can be. Everyone here understands crop insurance, revenue insurance. Yeah, we spend, about $40 per acre subsidizing crop insurance, ensuring you will have revenue or yield equivalent. What incentive is there to change? You know, Seth stabilizes income by diversity. I don't tell him how many income streams you've got, but he's got several. How do we stabilize income in a cornfield? Government. You know who the biggest lobbyist was for the current farm program? Who spent the most money? Give me a guess. No. Monsanto? No, it's a good guess, but for a different question. Wells Fargo. Crop insurance subsidiary. If we don't get that policy right, and that policy does drive incentive for behavior, all the regulation in the world isn't going to work. And relative to regulation, I think there's two questions you have to ask. Is the fight worth fighting? Water quality probably is. Is it a fight that you can win? When it comes to regulation, you're not going to regulate how much nitrogen a farmer puts in his planter or puts on his ground. Now, with a satellite, you may be able to identify whether or not there's permanent cover on highly erodible land, but you can't do something that requires so many foot soldiers. So, regulation sounds like a quick fix, and I'm on board with you. There's some things that are really bothersome, but we need to look at the unintended consequences of some of those things that we identify with the R word.
Hi, I'm having a little difficulty relating to what you're saying because I eat local and organic, and I don't think you're talking about my food. My concern, you know, they tested the salmon in Puget Sound, and they found everything that you can buy in a drugstore in those fish. I worry about Mary Greeley Hospital because you can just imagine the volume of drugs that goes out of that hospital into some pipe. And it seems to me that cancer in the United States is 40 to 50%, and I think we need to start thinking not about killing cancer, but about preventing it. And you know, what if we could have some kind of a system that would filter those drugs out of the water when it leaves the hospital, because that's a big concentration of drugs. And I'm worried about, you know, in Des Moines, you're drinking directly out of the river. In Ames, our water is 10 to 15 years old because it filters down through the ground and some of that stuff comes out, maybe, we hope. But I'm really concerned about that. Another thing is, you know, there's a lot of blame on farmers, but vanity lawn treatments in cities are 9 times the amount that you would spread on your field to have a good crop. And I think those should be banned. It's just vanity. And a lot of my neighbors are being responsible about their lawns. They're planting things other than grass. And the lawns are interesting and beautiful. But I think that, you know, like somebody bought my neighbor's house and PSA went over there, they sprayed urea. And my cat was foaming at the mouth that night. And my son was sick that weekend. And so I think we need to recognize that cities are big, big, big problems. And that people are big problems. And I would like for us to do something about all of those drugs that we take so readily.
Let me try really to underscore a couple of the points you make, a little disagreement on a couple, but I think generally I'm gonna be pretty supportive of what you're saying. The drug issue that I'm more concerned about in this state isn't what you take or comes out of Mary Greeley. We have 21 million hogs in this state. I'm a lot more concerned about what's going on in the livestock end of the world than I am, frankly, the folks that I'm seeing out here with 3 million inhabitants and a system of sewage treatment and sewage collection that deals with some, but certainly not as effectively as we'd like, frankly, because of the science. There's a gap there, a lot of things, and Seth mentioned endocrine disruptors. We're seeing a lot of things that have human health effects. They're not yet regulated, and frankly, we don't have the science yet to be able to treat it. I wanted to weigh in on your cities versus the world issue also. Just not to disagree with the idea that vanity lawn care is unacceptable, and from my advantage, should be regulated. Particularly at its extreme, but realistically in our watersheds, the Des Moines and Raccoon River, I'm at the confluence of the Raccoon into the Des Moines, 10,000 square miles, urban and suburban lawns are a pinprick in that process, very, very small portion of it. So they're not a meaningful contributor at all to the water quality problems that I see. That's, again, not to say that you should go out and put, you know, 3 inches of Scott's Turf Builder on your yard so you can mow it every 15 minutes, which is something I just don't get. But the real contributors to water quality issues in the state aren't from lawn fertilizers.
Well, excuse me, it's an air quality problem for me because I ride my bike around.
You know, and I don't disagree, again, but in terms of their net impact on what's going on and the water quality of the world, again, in our watersheds, we are an overwhelmingly cultivated row crop agricultural state, not a suburban state or an urban state.
We have a question back here and then one here.
My name is Mike Bryant. I came here tonight to learn. I have a farm kid. I was raised Republican. I saw the light and became a Democrat. When I moved to the city, I was the first of our family to go to college because we have. I do own a couple farms in northern Iowa, not in the particular shed area you're talking about, thank heavens. But I was able to put five kids through college. One of them went to Iowa, but they did not become a Hawkeye. It was a stipulation. Like tattoos, you couldn't have a tattoo until you're out of my house. Anyway, I'm a bit old school, so I'm raised with my grandparents, but I plan on those farms putting my six, probably going to have 10 grandchildren to college. I set it up as a trust. So I do have an interest, and not out of disrespect for one of the earlier comments, but I'm not a farmer, I'm a landowner. I think that whatever we look at, we have to look at not just what we say. We don't want to classify this as a farmer issue, it's a landowner responsibility issue. So depending upon what potential solutions we come up with, it has to be available to the landowner, ultimately to me, I feel, but I'm just, again, it's just my opinion. And I didn't know there was an opportunity for slides, so I didn't bring them anyway. But what I wanted to bring up more of an awareness, and this may not be in your wheelhouse, but again, I live in the city, so don't take this wrong, but I am tired of the things that the city folks bring to my farm. I can deal with the tires and the Christmas trees. Those aren't too bad. I don't appreciate the dead dogs. I don't appreciate the TVs. I don't appreciate the refrigerators, the microwaves, and probably an endless other things, the brush, the sticks, whatever. I can pick them up, but I don't really enjoy doing that. I'm a retired firefighter. I'd rather really go fishing and play with my grandkids. But I can't imagine that the things in TVs and computers and microwaves laying around in the ditches are ultimately going to do our water supply any good in the long run, even though I understand that this is a bigger problem that you're talking about here in the panel. But, I've talked to Beth about this in the past, but there's got to be a solution for people to get rid of these things somewhere without a huge burden, so they could bring them out to the country.
I can tell you that we did increase the penalty for doing that. But you have to catch them, and that's probably the biggest issue. I don't know if you have any comments up there.
Amen.
Science teachers, Mrs. Harkison, like last year, said that there used to be 18 to 19 feet of rich soil in Iowa. Now there's 9 feet of rich soil that is the plan. What is the plan to keep that soil rich? That 9 feet.
The soil. Your numbers are right. The units are should be in inches. That's okay. It's okay. We have lost roughly half of what was here when the Iowa was broken, when the prairie was broken. Now that's a little bit of a distortion too, because if you drive down Interstate 80 or 35 or any country road during the springtime when the ground is bare, you can see hill slopes where there is nothing. I mean, there's no topsoil left. That white soil that you see, or lighter colored soil, is subsoil. So it's zero. The question is, what are the plans to keep it in place? You know, I used to have a lot of youthful enthusiasm and thought I could generate stuff that would make that happen. I certainly don't have the youth anymore. The enthusiasm has probably waned too. I guess my response to that would be to you. You know, this is your world now more than mine. What can be done to keep that in place? We've done a pretty good job of failing. I can tell you that the soil erosion rates have, starting with the USDA estimates, in about 1982 were somewhere around 9 tons per acre per year. They dropped to a low in 1997 of about 5.2 tons per acre per year. Now those numbers won't mean much to you, except it was a drop of about 30%. They're starting to rise again. They've increased about 14% in the last 10 years. So do we have a plan?
No.
I know. You know, to fix water, you have to have a goal and be committed to it. To keep soil in place, you have to have a goal and be committed to it. We have selected individuals. This guy here on my right, left, whichever it is. I don't have my PowerPoint. It gets it. Seth gets it. And there are a variety of farmers out there that do get it. But I'll throw that question back to you. How do you make it happen?
I guess the only thing I'd add to that, because I appreciate your question very much. I really didn't start making money farming or make my, for my farm to be sustainable, it has to be profitable. But I went through an experience, a really terrible blizzard, and came through that and said, you know what, I don't want to see my cows, my helpers, or myself go through something like this again. I'm going to change and start having my calves in April instead of February. And what I did, though, my decision, you know, I asked the simple question, why am I working against Mother Nature? But more importantly, I realized I was focusing on the wrong thing. My entire focus was on production. You know, I'll pick on Iowa State a little bit. We always joke as farmers, if you listen to Iowa State, you'll learn how to spend $5 to make $3.
That's too generous.
Long story short, I really didn't care if I went broke or not. I decided, I wanted to be able to sleep at night and feel that I was doing right by my cows and right by the land. The beautiful thing is the other things fell into place. It's taken me 20 years to start to figure out why that actually happened. And it's a combination of increased soil health and increased production from it, and reduced costs from eliminating fixed costs, reducing my nitrogen, reducing my fossil fuel, all those things. The cool thing is there are a lot of people up here that can help you do that. And that's my goal. And I said earlier, I'm being the optimist because you have to be in this. But these things are infectious. Once people do it, Taylor County, which everyone makes fun of us being a bunch of Southern Iowa rednecks, but we probably have a higher percentage of cover crops in Taylor County than any county in the state of Iowa. For some reason, even though we're a bunch of rednecks, we all get together and we care a lot about our soil and we want to see something for our future. And that's how it starts.
Dr. Cruz, I'm going to address this to you, but if you're not unable to answer, maybe you can pass this on to Seth or something.
Let me see the cure the question first, then I'll decide if I can.
Right, whether you lost your voice or not. Early in the evening, you captured my imagination by saying that the best agriculture, I think you said this, the best agriculture tools we have are perennials. And I would like you to expand on that a little bit, what specific crops we're talking about, and also whether our agricultural college is talking about perennials very much.
I'll have a voice for part of that. Perennials are our best conservation tools for a variety of reasons. Number one, they're close growing, so they have the soil covered. And they're growing, they're covered throughout the year. You don't have to plant them again and again. Now, what are the perennials? I think that was another question. Well, you got alfalfa, which is the one that's probably most famous for livestock producers. But you have different types of forage and forage mixes that can be used for pastures and or for harvest. The requirement of fertility, fertilizer requirement for those are typically smaller. I say typically, if you have a livestock herd, you know, the nutrients that go in the front end and most of them come out the back end are put back on that ground. Relative to the soil itself, I might be getting too far in the weeds on this one, but we're going to try. Yosef has talked a lot about soil health. Soil carbon, soil organic matter, is a large component of the soil health toolbox. That soil organic matter dominantly comes from the root system of the plants that are growing in that field. For a corn crop, recent numbers have suggested only about 15% of the corn biomass is underground. You take some of the perennials, you've got 50%, in some cases 60% that grow underground. You've got roots scattered everywhere. Now, if you could see around a root, this is where I'm getting in the weeds maybe too far, but if you could see around a root, what happens to the soil water content during the day when the sun's shining and the plant is evaporating water? The soil gets drier because it's absorbed by the plant. What happens at night? Water moves towards that plant root. Have you ever seen an Iowa soil that is dry and it cracks so big that you could almost drop pliers down on? Okay, that's the type of clays we have in soil. So now, Matt, now take this picture around the root system. It's drying, it shrinks. It wets, it expands. It dries, it shrinks. It wets, it expands. It's got a lot of microbial activity around it at the same time. It creates a living environment underground that's as much more vibrant than where you have a root system that is much more dispersed than the less. It has a lot going for it. And maybe I went too far in the weeds to go there, but the perennials do absorb. They do take up mobile nutrients, especially nitrate, which helps immensely our water quality component.
Talking about this in the College of Agriculture?
Question is, are we talking about this in the College of Agriculture? Yeah, we are. We are. We have some people that are focusing. Some. When you mentioned the STRIPS project, STRIPS project is where they're actually implementing strips 10 to 30 feet wide in row cropped areas. And these strips are designed native for each species. So they're trying to integrate these perennials in the row crop system. Is there a lot of talk about moving livestock back on the landscape? Probably not, no. Well, I do. But I still have a job. I don't need that. That's all I have.
Socially or culturally, really when I came of age in agriculture, a lot of people thought I was nuts to stick with the cow thing. That was just the social pressure. Once again, you know, we've heard a lot about who's accountable for this, who should spend, you know, who should do what, and that's why I made the comment, you know, you can't put the toothpaste back in the tube. I have people going, you know, what are you raising those cows for? You're nuts. You can make more money raising crops. You can, you know, we can finance you for this tractor. We can do this, this, and this. What it really comes down to, what it all comes down to, is we have to find the most appropriate use for every acre we have. And that worked for me. I bucked a trend. Now, I had to laugh a little bit when the corn market crashed and everyone said I was smart to have a bunch of cows. And now they all feel better again because the markets have kind of gotten to a lower point. So, you know, there is that human nature, and that's what we kind of have to rise above that fray and not let those things hurt our feelings or bother us and just say what's really important. And what's important is farming in a way that I don't destroy the planet to feed us.
Afterwards, Dr. Ken Moore at Iowa State from the Agronomy Department is in the fifth year of a $25 million USDA-funded project called SenUSA Bioenergy, whose mission is to create a sustainable system based on perennial grasses to create biofuels and bioproducts throughout the Midwest. So this is happening. It's just very difficult to get traction.
Okay, I got the microphone, I guess. All right, so this is a sort of general question. I'm not sure there's going to be a great answer, and if you don't want to answer, that's fine. But the purpose of this little gathering here today was entitled Water Crisis. And what I'm interested in is two things. One is there is a, and I've had to listen to this, people who say there is no problem. This is like climate change, you know, there is no problem, all right? So First of all, do you have any great words of wisdom of how to stoke the fire and keep the interest in trying to improve Iowa's water quality? Because I think there is a problem. But there are people out there who will say, no, 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 it's kind of, well, the advertisement on TV that you can see right now would say there really isn't that much of a problem. The second part of it, if you get beyond that, is the slow walking of the process. I had to sit through a long presentation of somebody saying, it'll take decades for anything to happen. We'll do these processes and nothing will happen for decades. Well, shit, we're not going to have any soil after a couple of decades. So, you know, how do you stoke or how do you keep the fire going? You know, and I'll throw it out to you, and if you don't want to answer, we'll move on to the next question.
Bill's done a heck of a job of keeping the fire going.
Doctor, first, thanks for your hand in organizing this event. Great question. You know, realistically, as I mentioned, I think, in my opening remarks, Iowans have given up on this idea that this can be an environmentally balanced state. We have no intention of letting that center of gravity continue. We went into litigation, frankly, and there's a $1 million ad campaign with my picture on it. This isn't softball. This is a multi-billion dollar industry, and we're raising questions that aren't incremental. They're massive. So we certainly view ourselves as being a part of that process to change the debate. And how successful we are in not only changing the debate, but improving environmental quality in the state remains to be seen. We're in front of the Iowa Supreme Court tomorrow on some pretty technical issues. We're in front of a federal judge in about a year in our lawsuit. But, you know, everybody's a generalization. The center of gravity in Iowa is we want to be Iowa nice. We want to collaborate. We want to talk about it. Well, you know, when I think of collaborators, I think of the Nazi collaborators. That's not a good term for me. This is a huge issue, and we can disagree whether it's a problem or whether it's a crisis. I've gone through flood crises. I deal with professionals in Flint, as an example, or in LA. Their water quality issues are crisis issues. We will continue to move towards some solutions because there will be situations where people lose their drinking water supply. I've spent enough time on Lake Erie and Toledo with an algal problem that caused them to lose their water supply a couple years ago. Those kind of issues strung together will raise an awareness that can't be shaken very easily. Our neighbors, whether it's Wisconsin or Minnesota to our north, have an environmental ethic that's far different than us as Iowans. We need to change that, and I'm seeing a number of heads nod on this issue. This issue is not going to go away if we lose our lawsuit, because the crisis will come in a different form with different players, probably. But once we've turned this corner, and I think we have turned this corner, we are in local elections and state elections and federal elections going to be talking about environmental issues in a way we haven't in the past. And there are a lot of good reasons for that and a lot of good people involved in it. But you are all activists or you wouldn't be here. If you're not talking to all of your candidates about the need for accountability, the need for environmental protection, the need for public health concerns, then we're moving ourselves towards being a state that's a feedlot between the Mississippi and Missouri River. If that's where we want to be as Iowans, and there's certainly folks who will make money out of that, that's the direction that we've been heading for a long time. I think we're changing that direction. Are we changing it as quickly as I or a number of people I work with would want? No, but there will be crises and there will be accountability because of that. I'm hoping that the 500,000 people who I deliver this to are not part of that crisis, and I hope realistically we can avoid that. But nonetheless, Iowa NICE is not going to get us there. And the idea that we can collaborate through this problem solving with people who don't recognize it's a problem is in its of itself, I think, the larger problem.
Yes.
How do you keep it active? Vote wisely.
I think I have a question on how long it takes from a farming perspective. Mother Nature is really forgiving, is what my experience on the farm as I've adopted better practices. You know, Rick can answer this better than I can. I think the nitrogen issue with the right practices can turn around in a couple of years. Yeah. Phosphorus is a different issue because of where it is, but we can stop putting it in there. You know, those are a couple of the keys on it. So it can happen a lot faster than anyone. Don't be misled to think this thing will take decades if we have the right practices in place.
I have a question here. When I was growing up, I knew at age 18 I'd never marry a farmer because I didn't want to spend the rest of my life grading. So, for weather, whatever. But as along with that, I watched farm equipment get so big that my dad, well, my brother was the one, he'd start taking fence rows out where all the grasses were that held those nutrients, I think. And so, because he couldn't turn the equipment around because it was so big. So we had to make, instead of 40-acre fields, we made 80-acre fields. And I just, you know, bigger is not better. And I think that's part of the cow-calf program. Bigger is not better. You just get like a concentration. So maybe we need to talk to John Deere and those places and say, you know, your machines are so powerful, you take out the waterways. You don't want to slow down and lift up the equipment. So that's just a comment.
Any responses?
Bigger isn't better. That's why the ant's still here and the dinosaur's gone. It's a mixed bag. I completely agree. It goes back to the comment I made. Agriculture changed its course in 1973 with a policy decision. And this goes back to the importance of choosing wisely who you vote for and voting and doing some of these things. On the flip side, some of the things that farmers can do today with precision technology in some of these areas, those are things to be celebrated. So once again, you hate to throw the baby out with the bathwater. We've got to differentiate between the good and the bad in some of these things. And this is why I've said before, as we move in the right direction, it's going to take every tool in the toolbox. My system started using more chemicals and tillage and things like that. As I saw the benefits and saw how to put the pieces together, we've continued to use less and less. I have a much more resilient and profitable system because of this, but I had to start somewhere. And that comes back, I get very cautious and when people are worried about one aspect. The other thing we have to remember, and it doesn't get brought up very much, most people don't want to do this for a living anymore. You know, it's... You made a good choice. I don't know if you married a farmer or not, but I know my wife has some regrets on it because we don't go anywhere. I'm home every weekend. I miss church a lot. Some of these things, you know, there are parts of this job, and I think sometimes that's why farmers get their noses a little bit out of joint. When, you know, you have to kind of handle them with kids' gloves. But you can say anything to me. I got thick skin. But I think sometimes when you do think about that, you've got a career where you don't get to leave, you don't get to do things, and you've got this pressure to continue to get bigger to keep your revenue at a point to feed your family. You know, my financial goal is to buy a six-pack every Friday night and put my kid through college. That's made things a lot easier for me. I don't have to go to that level. Okay.
So I'm going to call this the last question, and I apologize to anybody I didn't get to, but this is an amazing crowd of people who want to ask questions. I hope you will all show up at the forums and ask us some really good democratic questions. And I have six forums coming up. They're all posted at Story County headquarters. So if you have more questions, come on over and we'll start there.
Hi,
Growing up, my dad taught us to swim in the Wapsipinicon and later in the Cedar. I've done tubing in the Skunk, but today I would never fish in those waters and I wouldn't walk in those waters. So I do think we have a crisis. I'm a member of Iowa CCI and we have been yelling that we have a water crisis. My question is, the sales tax that is proposed is regressive. Sales taxes are regressive. Any ideas, comments on how you would fund what we can do to improve our water?
I'm going to sound like Rick on this one. I won't lose my voice, but I'm speaking only for myself and certainly not for the board of trustees who I work for. I perfectly agree that a sales tax is regressive. I serve water to a community where 75% of the students in the Des Moines public school system receive subsidized lunches. So hitting their parents with a sales tax to me is heinous. I simply do not believe it's good public policy. And realistically, doesn't generate enough money. It simply won't. A lot of it will go to recreational uses, not to water quality uses. Setting that aside, where would I find money? I'm still struggling with the idea that this is something that needs to be publicly funded. As I mentioned to you earlier, came from the petroleum business, worked in power plants, worked in oil refineries. When there was a public policy that said, stop polluting the air, there was no pile of public money that came to my employers and said, oh, here it is, now you can clean up your act. The shareholders and owners as producers internalized that cost and paid for it. Farming may or may not be a different issue. I certainly recognize that sympathetically it may be, but realistically the polluter should pay in my view, and whether the polluter is the producer farmer or the landowner, I don't care. I just want cleaner water coming through those pipes and into the waters of the state.
How about a tax on fertilizer and chemicals?
A tax on inputs, you know, certainly that has attraction. There are some of those taxes there now. There is a nitrogen tax now. It certainly isn't large enough, in our view, to be able to make a difference with that. That's certainly an option. I, again, am more interested in regulating what's coming out of that pipe, because once we regulate that, there's accountability. How the solution is paid for is a public policy issue that you and I can certainly disagree on. It may be an income tax, it may be a sales tax, it may be a nitrogen tax. Frankly, I don't care as long as the water coming out is less than 10 parts per million or wherever the science takes us at the time that we have public health standards on it.
So one thing to remember with the funding issue on the agriculture side, usually that's administered to us as farmers on a cost share basis. So it's usually a dollar and I contribute a dollar or a dollar for $2, things of that nature. So it does go a little farther than it appears. I shared Bill's sentiments about the oil industry too. My brother's in that business and they're pretty clear cut. And I will point out that, you know, there's a side of me that wonders on part of this as we've moved in to producing fuel. Is that, should that be treated differently than beef or food, some of those issues? You know, those are fair questions, but it comes back again, there does need to be a funding source, and most likely farmers will take it as a cost share, so it will stretch your dollar. Can I ask one last question?
Yeah. Sure.
If this did go to a judge, could he come out with a ruling that would have no impact whatsoever on our soil and how we farm and things? I mean, that's what I don't want to see. This is why I don't want to see this go to a judge. Could a judge come and just rule on the nitrogen alone and do nothing to offset the other things I'm worried about in our water that I want to fix as a farmer?
Could, yes. Do I think that's likely? No. But I mean, the answer is certainly that's a risk that it only, assuming we even make it that far, Seth, gets us to a point where it's looking at a very narrow issue with 10 drainage districts in 3 counties.
Okay, let's give a round of applause to our three panelists, Jeff, Griff, and Bill. Thank you very much for everything that you provided for us. I have a couple more thank yous. Andy Tang and Danny Goodrich were responsible for the sound system and recording this, so thank you very much for doing that. Marsha Thompson was responsible for the cookies. Thank you, Marsha, for the cookies. And when they say the way to change this is to vote, that also means getting behind some candidates who think it's a serious issue. And I think you have some candidates in the Story County Democrats who do think it's a serious issue. You can stand up, all of you, again, even without Story County Democrats that are on it, and you might be able to have an impact on water quality, on soil conservation. Make sure you get behind these candidates, including myself. We need letters to the editor. We need yard sign locations. We need dollars. Anything that you can do to get behind us, and make sure you get out there to vote. Sherry's carrying her envelopes for contributions. We need door knockers. We need people out there registering voters, making sure they get to the polls. We need a GOTV effort. All those things are helpful. We need to get Democrats back in control. Thank you.